Ladies and gentlemen, I have been given the great pleasure and honor to introduce Professor Gregory Claes of the History of Political Thought at Royal Holloway University of London. Professor Claes is known for pretty much everything, but I'll try to keep it in a nutshell. So firstly, Professor Claes has received Communal Studies Distinguished Scholar Award in 1995, Lyman Tower Sargent Distinguished Scholar Award in 2002, and has been elected for the European Academy in 2015, and the most recent of committees that he has been elected for is the Chief of the Utopian Studies Society in Europe. So, we have the pleasure of welcoming the very most important head of Utopian Studies Society. Professor Claes has edited over 50 publications on political history and utopia, but he is most well known in our society for editing the Cambridge Companion to Utopian Literature. His recent work was published in December, and it is the book that you can see here called Dystopia and Natural History. He also wrote the preface to a volume edited by Ksenia Olkush, Krzysztof Meyer, and myself, the book More After More, Essays Commemorating the 500 Years of Utopia. He's currently working on the Pelican Introduction to Marx and Marxism. Professor Claes, it is an honor, and the stage is yours.
Thank you so much for that introduction, and also to Factor Victor and Ksenia and Krzysztof for inviting me back again. I guess they didn't get enough of me the first time, and welcome to all of you, and welcome back to those of you who were in the early sessions this morning. So I'm going to talk this morning from this book, which is only just out and has not presumably been seen by practically anybody here. Although those of you who were in the early session this morning realize that the theme of monstrosity is in fact interwoven with that of dystopia, it was not at one time the case that that assumption was a very common one. And so what I've tried to do in a fairly lengthy section of the book, which I've both condensed in the talk this morning and elaborated on, is to look at some of the points of intersection between a theme which historically has only been marginal or tangentially related to dystopia and what I think is a rather more central rendition of that theme, particularly in the material relating to the 20th and the 21st century, when in fact, as we'll see, monstrosity is reinvented in some, as we saw in relation to Margaret Atwood this morning, in some quite extraordinary ways, to come back to our consciousness once again as a dystopian trope. So let me just start with a definition, because this is also a controversial point, and I spend a very lengthy part of the book addressing this. So in one line, and this has to make sense in order for you to see how far I want to push my argument here. A dystopia is either an entire society or a very large area which is dominated by one or another forms of evil and produces extreme fear or anxiety on the part of those subject to this evil. That's, I think, a relatively uncontentious definition in what is normally, as all of you are aware here, a highly contentious field. So what I want to argue then is that one can produce out of a series of narratives basically a nine-part history. I like enumerating things according to points because it gives us a sense of how we move along here, which gives us a sense of the centrality of imaginary evil spaces, which, as you can see, works well for what I've just said about dystopia, as at certain points intersected with monstrosity, and much more importantly, at other points dominated by monstrosity. The point of domination occurs only when monsters are present in sufficient numbers. So if we start with two familiar late 19th century monstrous tropes, Frankenstein and Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, we have single figures. Frankenstein, of course, doesn't get a mate. That's the tragedy of the whole story. He never becomes a sociable monster, which has a very interesting gloss, I think, on the history of utopianism. But there's just the one creation, Frankenstein. Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, more complex story, obviously, because there isn't a creation, but the monster lies within. I'll return to this theme later on. But again, we have only one mad person. So this is not a dystopian rendition of the monstrous or of monstrosity. The monsters have to swarm. They have to be present in large numbers, as you'll see they do become, in order to become dystopian. Third part of the argument, which I can't, unfortunately, unpack this morning, owing to lack of time, is that imagining monstrosity is the flip side of imagining utopia, EU, as the good place, or the Edenic, original state of mankind. Story here becomes much more complex and much more interesting because, of course, as we'll see in the illustrations, which I will do after the talk, not during, the monstrous is present, of course, in the Christian narrative of Eden from the very beginning. Satan, the snake figure in the tree, which kind of ruins the story if what you want out of that story, of course, is the utopian idea of Eden, because the dystopian element is present in the first instance. But I can't explore that. So, first of the nine phases, the mentality we associate with the earliest forms of society, which anthropologists used to call the primitive mentality, but that's not very PC, of course, anymore, imagines that we envision a world around us which is populated by spirits, mostly of the dead, but belonging also to a wide variety of natural objects, rocks, springs, mountains, waterfalls, clouds, etc. Many of the spirits we encounter, we are afraid of. This is the worldview known as animism, and need to be propitiated by us through some form of sacrifice or other. But the crucial part of this is that we're afraid. We live in fear of a world which is effectively surrounding us. Some of these spirits occasionally assume material forms, and some of them have the ability to move from material form to an ethereal or unmaterial form. We're familiar, even in our very late stage, with the folklore here relating to elves, sprites, kobolds, demons, trolls, fairies, and so on. Typically, inhabiting spaces immediately beyond our inhabited towns, usually beginning at the edge of the town, often in medieval Europe in particular, inhabiting the forest. Trolls, of course, live under bridges in the forest, and so on. This is the first imagined evil space where the sense of psychological threat attached to these large numbers of spirits becomes, as it does in some societies but not in others, sufficiently intense for us to be alarmed psychologically. So there's a flexibility in this vision, depending upon how much anxiety is created. Clearly, psychologists and psychoanalysts tell us animality at this earliest level represents violence and a sense of the beast within, the animal within. So that's the starting point. The second point, phase two, is where in, we'll mostly be talking about Europe here, where in the ancient world, we begin to have a much more material and concrete sense of what the monstrous is, and specifically where particular kinds of monstrous races or species live. The three great sources here are the classical historians, Ctesias, Megasthenes, and Pliny, who describe, amongst other things, we'll see some illustrations of a couple of these, the Abiriman people of Scythia, whose feet point backwards, the Albanians, who see better by night than by day and are born gray-headed, the warrior women people of the Amazons, sometimes described as unusually lustful, the Androgyny, man, woman, another narrative we'll pick up later in Africa, the anthropophagi, man-eaters, who in some narratives eat their parents when old. Great solution to the problem of growing elderly population. Other races described here walk upside down, some on all fours, like animals. There are whole races of bearded or hairy women, the gorillae, others who have only one eye, like Homer's Cyclops, or horns and tails, the Gegetones or Gorgones, who hint, of course, at the person who in the book, although not in the talk, is the central villain of this entire account, of course, Satan, whom I've already mentioned. There are also races described, for example, by Theseus, as having ears which reach down to their feet and serve as both blankets and wings, the Penatii. These would appear on maps in the medieval period as late as the 13th century. Now, the crucial moment of the development of this narrative is the story called the Alexander Romance, which is attached, of course, to tales emanating from Alexander the Great's conquest as far as India. At a particular point, Alexander, somewhere probably in the Caucasus, decides that he will bound off his territories with a great wall. Mr. Trump didn't come up with the idea first. Marking the frontier between the barbarians and the civilized peoples. But it turns out that in many glosses, there are many different accounts of this narrative in manuscript, many glosses here, the barbarians include monstrous races. The Hereford map, for example, those of you who know anything about this, of around 1300, shows a zone of monsters as existing on the other side of this iron, enormous iron gate and the wall, who include cannibals, griffins, and a race of one-eyed men, all destined, in some of the narratives, to be released by the Antichrist prior to the apocalypse. So there is a classical narrative imposed upon a previous narrative of monstrosity, imposed upon that, then a third layer of a Christian narrative, all neatly interwoven, and it makes a great bedtime story for medieval children, of course. The most famous text of this period to describe monstrous domains is, of course, Sir John Mandeville's Travels. What little we know of Mandeville, he never traveled anywhere and sat in his library imagining a great many things, but this was an extraordinarily important text. It described races with, for example, the Ethiopians, who had a foot so large that it could shade their entire body against the sun. The inhabitants of the Armenian desert, who had one arm and one foot and had to pair up in order to shoot their bows. Desert dwellers in the land of Prester John, those of you familiar with the utopian trope here will recognize this, who had horns and couldn't speak but grunted like pigs, and a country where all the men were born shaped like mankind, but the males were born, we'll see an illustration of this, like unto dogs, as Mandeville puts it, with men's heads but dogs' faces, possibly an extrapolation of the wolfman concept, which I discussed in the book and have one illustration of. Throughout this narrative, and from fairly early on, there emerges one figure which will come to the center in later medieval discourse, the dragon figure, of course. And the realization in the famous, most famous trope of this, of St. George killing the dragon, of the very clear symbolism of the dragon as, in the Christian culture, Satan and the representation of the ultimate forces of evil, and St. George as, of course, the Christian conqueror of this. The third phase, then, is explicitly Christian. It is the consolidation within Christianity from about the 10th, 11th century to about the 17th of all of the pre-existing animistic evil spirits and their enlisting under a Christian banner chiefly as demons. So what the church does is it takes all the ancient gods and goddesses and various forms of spirits and it adjusts them according to the Christian worldview, demoting the vast majority into the mere status of demons, whom we see most characteristically in the period, in gargoyles, in churches, and promoting one to become the great principle of evil, of course, Satan. The devil by now assumes, we're talking about the 12th, 13th century, the form which is familiar to most of us, perhaps from our childhood. The horns, the tail, the cloven hooves, the large phallus, the sexual symbolism is extremely important, coming from the Greek god Pan, a sulfurous smell, probably coming from Scandinavia. The sense across about five centuries of the presence of the devil in everyday life leads us to what has been described as a spiritual holocaust by the 17th century, a sense of not merely the omnipresence of the devil, constantly existing in the form of every kind of temptation imaginable, down at the pub, appearing in 100 different forms to tempt us to vice. And the sense of the fear which results from this, we get from many 17th century narratives, becoming so dominant that we need merely to quote from Martin Luther in this, the whole world is possessed by Satan. So we move to a portrait then where one central evil figure appears to instill such a powerful sense of fear in a very large percentage of the population that for practical purposes, according to the definition I started with, the entire world becomes dystopian. Paradoxical, perhaps. Within this, of course, at the same time, we have a second set of narratives about hell as the classical dystopian place. When we reach the 20th century and when we look for analogies of what human beings do to one another, Auschwitz is just a few kilometers, of course, from here, and many of those who were sent there, certainly from this region at least, were sent by people who sat in this very room. This was Gestapo headquarters during the war. So we have a very clear proximity in the sense of what we're talking about here. The description of that life, and the central third of this book is about real dystopias in the 20th century, but Stalinism plays a rather bigger role here than National Socialism, is of course the trope of the Christian idea of hell. Everyone who has some experience of Auschwitz describes hell as the only analogy possible. In the book, I try to argue that this is quite mistaken. Actually, hell is not nearly as bad a place in many respects as Auschwitz was. There's something wrong with our language here, in other words. So, in the fourth phase, something quite interesting happens for the later development of the real narrative. Anti-Semitism becomes wedded to monstrosity. Pictures of Jews with horns on their heads, wearing Jews' badges or hats to show that we know they have to be Jews. Portrayals of Gog and Magog as blood-drinking cannibals with Jewish features. Transferal of the idea of monstrosity, in other words, from external spiritual beings onto the real antagonistic enemy, the other in this life. Second part of this, the fifth phase here, is a similar transferal through misogyny, which of course is the official doctrine vis-a-vis women in Catholic medieval times, the extension to women of the idea of monstrosity through the witchcraft craze. The same time, not only are, therefore, Jews demonized, as we say today, this now is, we see a literal description of what's being happened, of what's happening. Jews are demonized, and also conquered peoples, particularly in the Spanish New World, are demonized. In the famous debate in 1550, 1551, they're described as homunculi, semi-human beings, in other words, monstrous, rather than real human beings. Hence, it's quite legitimate to see them as one pleases. The sixth phase, for those who adhere to this view, entertains the idea that there's a general decline. I'm somewhat dubious about this, but let's run with the argument for the time being, in the belief in the monstrous in the 18th century, the age of so-called enlightenment. Voyages of discovery have identified those bits of the world which used to be mapped out as populated by these strange races of monsters, and lo and behold, they're not there. Even Columbus, when he went to the New World, expected to find monsters. He didn't. So the maps are being repainted, literally. The monsters are being painted out, and monstrosity becomes consigned, effectively, to the museum of the human imagination. Dragons disappear, of course, demoted into figments of our imagination. A belief in Satan declines dramatically. Demons generally become what the great St. George of later modernity, Sigmund Freud, because he's killing the monster, calls creations of the human mind. So within a secular worldview, monsters become figments of our unconscious. Some of them had some basis in reality. We all recognize discoveries of dinosaur bones, narwhals, various creatures. But they turn out just to be animals, in turn, rather than monsters. So the really threatening monsters disappear completely because they turn out to be figments of our own imagination. Seventh phase, however, then sees a curious reinvention of monstrosity in the Victorian period. I've mentioned Frankenstein, Dracula, of course, a familiar trope here as well. Each of these having long separate histories, which one can deal with in some detail. Monstrous dystopias now assume the form of literary works. H.G. Wells's The Island of Dr. Moreau, of course, the first major text in which we have eugenically driven monstrosity. Aliens appear for the first time. Wells, again, The War of the Worlds, from exactly the same period, the year after. We think in the 20th century of King Kong, Godzilla, and so on. The eighth phase sees another transformation in a quite different way. And this is the one which I think is, from judging from what I've gotten by way of feedback from my own students, the most relevant of the lot for most modern readers. The age of machinery gives us, of course, the idea of the robot. Once a figment, again, of the imagination, now today, of course, not mechanical monsters, but supposedly helpmates. But this remains to be seen, of course. We have now the invention of androids, synthetic or synth-like persons who resemble people, of cyborgs, people who have mechanical parts, of clones, aliens, and so on, such that by the middle to late 20th century, we have a spectrum ranging from the so-called wholly organic or purely original human through a variety of types, which, as we move further and further into science fiction, are then interwoven, the various artificial and natural elements, to the fully artificial, wholly created at the other end of the spectrum. And we have the very beginnings, of course, the very end of the 20th century, beginning of the 21st, then of the post-human debate that was mentioned earlier this morning, where we can fairly readily imagine that within 60 to 70 years, because of the harvesting of organic organs and our replacement in the eternal quest for longevity, because of the use of cyborg-related artificial devices, we will ourselves become less and less human in the original organic sense, and more hybrid in our composition. And that, of course, is bound to create some sense, as robots in particular, the wholly artificial devices, become more and more human, and we become in turn more and more mechanical, that is bound to create a tremendous crisis of identity, in which there will be some sense of, no doubt, the loss of the human. So the ninth phase, then, of this debate sees, in the late 19th century, the transferal of some of the elements of the monstrous to the crowd. The sense that, as Europe and North America in particular become more and more urbanized, and larger groups of people come together, the sense that the identity of the group as crowd takes on the attributes of the most primitive types of people. It is, in other words, the crowd is atavistic. It reverts back to the primitive, less educated, more instinctively driven type of human being. And that, in turn, is used by Gustave Le Bon, who is the great theorist here, The Crowd, A Study of the Popular Mind of 1896. That leads us into a critique, in the first instance, of democracy, later on of various forms of collectivism, including fascism, national socialism, totalitarianism, like the various Soviet types as well. Here the crowd is described as unconscious, ecstatic, moved by contagion and suggestibility. Le Bon suggests that it is, quote, a barbarian, that is, a creature acting by instinct. So there is a sense of a reversion back to the original animal herd condition. The herd, of course, those of you know your Nietzsche, being the most derogatory term used in this respect. And Le Bon, of course, is taken up by Freud first and foremost. So this is an extraordinarily important account. Group Psychology and the Analysis of the Ego of 1921 often substitutes the word crowd for the group that Le Bon described. So let me conclude this part of the narrative, and then we can move on to the pictures. It seems that, to take Freud as a starting point here, the trope of monstrosity is a necessary part of humanity's existence. We must have monsters. They perform an absolutely central role in our conception of our identity, in our definition not only of ourselves, but in our definition of ourselves as juxtaposed to others. And it's very difficult, if you think about it for a moment, to imagine ourselves existing without those creatures who we're defined against. And therefore, when the various prototypes that I've very cursorily outlined here die out, we need to reinvent monsters to do the work that the preceding forms of monstrosity did, but now, having killed them off, we need others to take their place. So the purpose of monstrosity as such is as a device to talk about human identity. It is in particular, and this is where we can diverge relatively easily into a discussion of utopianism, it is a way of getting at the discussion of ideals of beauty and virility in particular, the utopia as a model human type, in other words, and we'll talk about eugenics in this regard, and to look at their opposites, mortality and death, decay, madness, deformity, and malady. All of these have a bearing on how we conceive of the monstrous. So when monsters cease to exist, like the devil, which for practical purposes most people don't believe in the guy with the forked tail and the horns anymore, we think it's an imaginary being, we have to invent them. So in come the most popular of the monsters we encounter today, zombies. In large numbers, the zombie apocalypse, a new dystopian trope. Vampires, the second most popular of all for the younger generation in particular. Again, if you ask people, do you really think zombies exist? I mean, you first ask them when you're teaching this, do you really think the devil exists? You talk about poor fairies. You can go back to the beginning of the nine parts of the story and ask them which they start believing in. When you finally reach zombies and vampires, you say, well, these are extremely popular. People go to films all the time to read novels about. Do you believe these creatures really exist? Because we know that our ancestors in the Middle Ages really did believe that demons and fairies and elves and the devil indeed existed, because they had to. And they say no. So what's going on here? The entire story has actually been dramatically transformed. We still have the monstrous types, but the function might be the same, but the content no longer is. So this seems to indicate at the very least that we must have monsters. If we don't have monsters, we can't have a hero. We can't have a Theseus if we don't have a Minotaur. We can't have a Saint George if we don't have a dragon. Indeed, we can't have beauty if we don't have a beast. Some of you may well be aware that the best-selling cinema performance at the moment is, again, the Disney rendition of exactly this title. and in the words of John Wesley, no devil, no God. So we're working within anybody's philosophically inclined here might want to pick up on this in questioning. We're working here with a clear, what was earlier described, I think really in mythological terms, of a clearly dualistic mythology in which our ability to break out of the dualism is well nigh impossible, even when the things which the ideal types point to, i.e. the devil or vampires or whatever monstrous trope it is, no longer have any real epistemological substance for us. That is, we simply don't believe them. So, let me move to illustrating some of this now.
There he is.
I won't comment on the angle of the lightsaber here, but this is, of course, because you're going to pick up on this a bit later, this is, of course, just the latest incarnation of our old friend Satan, except he's a cyborg in this case, but he is the representative of the evil principle. So in order to make sense of this, we have to march backwards now. Is this going to work? No, it goes forwards. Okay, that's why. So, and to look, we start with the classical world. This, of course, is the multi-headed dog, Cerberus, who, if you can see at least the two heads here, that's, there are many, many illustrations of this. He is in marble in Florence, the Pitti Palace, as you may know this. So these are the guardians, in this case one, of the golden apples of the Hesperides, if any of you know this myth. The point about this in part is to alert you to the pre-Christian nature of the image of the snake in the tree, which is actually quite common, as we'll see, to a number of other different cultures. An early version of the dragon theme here. This is also about 350 BC. And here, if you can see it in this picture, it's not as clear as I would like it to be, but you've got the snake slash dragon again with feet attached. This is one of the earliest of the vampire prototypes. This is, from the Greek, a lamia, a winged woman, often having serpent feet. It's come out of snake cults, of course, in the ancient world, carrying off a newborn child. You see the overlap here between witchcraft and the early image of the vampire. So the most famous instance of the Greek rendition of the snake cult, of course, Medusa, beautiful version of that, but again, there are many. This is one of the earliest, a bit crude, this one, in terms of the artistic value, one of the earliest renditions of the griffin. Again, note, and the Etruscans were well known for their snake cults, so the snake tail here is the rendition, but it's a very quizzical look. I love the goatee on this guy. So this is probably much more familiar, those of you who know it. Also Etruscan, but very late, far and away the most beautiful of all the renditions. This again is from the Archaeological Museum in Florence. Here, two animal themes in addition to the leonine head, the goat's head growing out of the back and the snake tail attacking the head. These are called chimera. Later on, of course, in English, we adopt that word for somewhat different uses. Another griffin, but Greek in this case, but I think artistically rather cut above the Etruscan version. So this is Pan. Now Pan is important, as I indicated, because he's one of the principal progenitors for Satan. Hence the phallus, hence the horned head. So What happens then is the Christian Church simply takes up earlier images, integrates them into the portrait it wants people to understand Satan to represent. And Pan has a thing about goats. So this is from Herculaneum. So this is one of the few renditions we have of Alexander's gate. It's difficult to get this fairly clear, but you can see on the lower part of the illustration here, the various spotted creatures on the bottom as representing, this is from the 13th century, representing some of the alien races who are excluded by the black wall, which is in the middle of the picture. So this is, as far as I can reckon, this is the first graphic representation of a space dominated by monsters, confronting a civilized space. The map I mentioned from Hereford about 1300 gives us the earthly paradise on the bottom, which is surrounded again by a wall with, it's not very clear here unfortunately, some monstrous type creatures outside of it, juxtaposed to the heavenly paradise on the top of the map. So the earthly paradise here is in the middle, depicted as a kind of island. You could sort of see the tree there in the middle, but these look better if you can blow them up. Adam and Eve, the most familiar image we have of the original interpolation of Satan into the Christian story. This one is particularly good, I think, because of the human features of the snake. Most of the versions that we have of this make the snake look like an ordinary snake, and children growing up were not taught that this is supposed to be Satan. Simply imagine that there's a silly snake in the tree tempting Eve with the apple and so on. And the whole thing doesn't make very much sense. When you give him a human head, it's a great deal more graphic, I think. But the bottom, of course, you can see still the tail there. So this is another version, again, I think very nicely done because of the human-like nature of the head attached to the snake. But when I was growing up, we never saw any of these humanoid snakes. They were always just plain snakes. So this is a pagan idol, again, called Baphomet from the 11th century. Now comes the devil again, and we begin to see some of the characteristics I pointed to here. Note the feet, you can just catch one of them here. A tail, not a very large one in this case. The wings, the goat's head, obviously taken over directly from Pan. Here, intimidating. I've got several portraits of the devil. Here, one witch is being carried off to hell. This may be the beast the devil is riding, called the nightmare, which is where we get our English word nightmare in a single word from, the horse that carries off souls to hell. So here's the devil again, not a brilliant artistic rendition, but he appears to be soliciting infants in this version. Note the demons in the sky, also above him, who would in some accounts have been visible and in other accounts not visible, just to keep you on your toes. Note that the devil is black here. He does come in different colors in the medieval and early modern period, but he gradually moves more and more towards being principally black, the racial association being, I think, pretty clear. Here he is again. The witch riding the broom. This is a phallic symbol, the broom. There are earlier portraits of flying penises, believe it or not, from a much earlier stage, and it is usually thought that the broomstick symbol is taken over from this particular idea. But the devil gets to ride one too. So this was a typical illustration of what witches got up with. They kissed his rear end. I leave it to you to work out the symbolism of this, but it's extremely commonly reported in witch trials. Again, you note pretty common symbolism here, the horns, the wings, the tail, the feet. Similar again, somebody in a tree playing some music. Note here that we've got two devil figures at the same time, but one appears to be a demon, the guy on the left, and the guy in the middle with the wings would appear to be the devil person, but it's not entirely clear. But you could have multiple renditions clearly at the same time. So anti-Semitism begins to come in here. This is believed to be a rendition of a Jew on a Norwich tax roll, 15th century. So, but again, look at the features, look at the horns, it's quite clear how the symbolism is supposed to be brought together here. So, the Last Judgment, of course, gives us the clearest possible rendition of the transition from this world to the world to come, which would be either above or below. This one is interesting in part because the various associates of the devil, demons namely, those who are flying all around here, are clearly present here. There is on the far right a devil-like figure also, sort of mounting an outcrop of rock here. There are various other kinds of flying creatures. They're not all of the same type here, but they all appear to be associates of the devil. In the lower part of the picture, in the center, you also see several black figures, and also lower down here, again, demons, possibly the devil himself. Bosch is, of course, the best known of all of those to represent hell in the goriest possible detail. I've got a couple of illustrations of this. Those of you who know the painting know that there's vastly more of it being devoured here. Again, he had a wonderful imagination for the pains to come. So this is one of 1,000 possible examples that you could use of St. George and the dragon. This dragon looks very much like a crocodile, which of course is one of the original impulses for the descriptions that we get in this period. We also know very clearly that when dinosaur bones were being dug up as early as classical Greece, this was one of the major sources for mythology about the earliest stages of human history, particularly the idea that a race of giants existed in the world, giant human beings as well as giant animals being supposed to exist. And that, of course, comes into the Bible then as well. So Mandeville then is the source, as I suggested, for I think probably about two-thirds of the graphic image of monstrosity that is not directly related to the devil, but emanates from actually existing monstrous spaces which have not yet been conquered or traveled through. So here we see there's the one foot which you can use to shade yourself from the sun. The headless person. There's a couple of further examples here. Dog-headed, cynocephalus. Again, the headless creatures. The coloring also, of course, is really great on a lot of these. Some have the faces on the back and some on the front. And there they are again. This sea creature is interesting because it's an amalgam of devil-like features with those associated with other forms of sea monster. And of course, for the seafaring nations, particularly Spain, Portugal, Britain, France, in the 15th, 16th, 17th century, sea monsters are a very commonly reported variant on the theme of the monstrous. Most of them, I mean, the narwhal, for example, we know is one source of sea monsters, giant squids, large types of whales, other simple natural phenomena, animals. This clearly is an attempt to try to wed together different types of monstrous trope. And note the multi-footed creature on the bottom right of this. So most people, this is a sea version of the unicorn, usually assumed to be taken from the rhinoceros, of course. Unicorn is that is often associated with positive rather than negative things. One of the very few, besides mermaids, types of monsters, which actually are usually benign rather than usually evil. Another interesting sea monster, because it has devilish characteristics, the large horned creature here out on the left. Not a very good woodcut, but still plenty to offer the imagination there. These are sirens here, familiar to you from classical mythology as well. Difference between a siren and a mermaid, of course, is the difference between evil and good, essentially. And then we get to the modern types. The Wolfman, it's very clear that Hollywood picks up on the Beauty and the Beast motif almost constantly when rendering the monstrous in the age of film. And there are very few of these films which don't try to pick up and then play out on this theme. So this is the great Lon Chaney, of course. Dracula, perhaps the greatest of all. Bela Lugosi. Frankenstein, this is, I think, the 1931 version. Curse of Frankenstein, again. A really botched job there. Godzilla, 1956. They were really crap at special effects, sadly, in those days, but nonetheless, for the period, it's convincing, isn't it? This is the first King Kong. He's rather a sweet fellow, I find. He's got sort of, you would call it a toothless grin, except it's a toothful grin in his case, but he seems indeed to portray that aspect of the monstrous, which plays up the essential innocence, naivete, lack of complicity in human guilt, which is an underlying theme that runs through a lot of monstrous tropes. Fay Wray, again, in the hands of King Kong. So then we get degenerative humanity as a monstrous trope. And this, of course, runs all the way through, again, parallel from the classical world onwards. Conjoined humans. Most of these, of course, would have been killed at birth in almost all societies. As indeed, and I didn't have a chance to get into the etymology of this, but monere, from which we get the word monster, means to show or to demonstrate or to portend. The signs which were given by a monstrous birth of this kind, as it would have been called, would have been regarded as hugely inauspicious, i.e. as portending some great threatening evil to come. Therefore, you had to kill or get rid of the sign, so to speak. Excessive hairiness, also linked with the Wolfman theme, of course. A great version of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, if you haven't seen it before. And there we come to a more recent rendition. The zombie and the zombie apocalypse, which is getting definitely something to look forward to. One illustration of the crowd is monstrous. It's very difficult to get one here, but this is a lynching from the American South. It's from the 1940s, I think. And then last but not least, my favorite monster. Isn't it cute? So, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Let's start our discussion. Yes? First.
Yeah, I was interested in vampires. I wanted to learn more because you position them as monsters, whereas in the young adult literature, and of course I'm in Twilight, we've got this monster as an ideal human, like post-human, something we want. Does this still count as monstrosity?
Okay, that takes us back to really the beginning of the discussion of the entire subject, because exactly the same question could come up vis-a-vis almost any of the types that I discuss. Namely, what constitutes a monster to start with? If I've included, as I have hinted I'm doing here, types which include on the surface, if we look at the Jekyll and Hyde example, everyday normal human beings whose monstrosity is only buried within them. Are they monsters as such, or are we looking at the development in from one type into another type? And therefore, what knock-on effect does this have upon all the preceding forms? Now, my sense is that the vampire is a tricky one because we don't superficially have the kinds of distinguishing characteristics that we have with respect to almost all the other forms emanating from the same period. As I mentioned here, in the earliest incarnations of this, in the Lamia particularly, this is classical Greece, these are winged demons who provide a prototype for the later vampire myth. But as you know, the vampire myth as we know it, the Transylvanian version of it, is a quite late redevelopment, reincarnation, reinvention. It's very topical today because it appears that a great deal of the reinvention has to do with immigration. And the monstrous trope is actually an Orientalist trope in which the vampire stands for the conquering hordes, effectively behind Alexander's Gate, who are now being released and are heading towards Western Europe. So the question here is the vampire in that later, particularly 17th, 18th century incarnation, where there are no distinguishing monstrous characteristics? Now, let's say this to start with, when we see the figure of a Bela Lugosi or someone, the rendition. What happens? What happens at night to the vampire is transformation into an animal, namely the bat. So in that form, the vampire is clearly monstrous. In superficial appearance, not, but the ability to transform shape-shifting, witches were often accused of exactly the same thing. The ability to assume, which of course goes back to animism as well, to the very beginning of my story. It was assumed, it is assumed still in a great many societies, which still share the belief system called animism, that the possibility of that transformation exists, particularly that witch doctors or witches have the ability to transform themselves into animals. So in the case of the vampire, we're still looking at a very familiar trope. By day, then, we might say, the vampire is not monstrous in his or her visage, clearly, but yet the fact of being able to engage in shape-shifting and to become an animal makes them something dramatically other than human. Now, I suspect I could talk about this much longer, but we probably want to look at other aspects of the theme. This is not going to satisfy everyone by any means, but it's not clear that one definition absolutely will satisfy all of the very varied types of tropes that come under the generic heading. So I don't know if that, does that help with your query?
Yeah, because in the newest renditions, actually, there is no shape-shifting. However, there are some superhuman powers which are located in a character that is associated with monstrosity. So, well, it creates certain discourse about superhuman powers. But yeah, I agree. So the monstrosity lies within their transgressing humanity somehow.
And if we look at the Freudian take on this, if essentially all of this is a projection onto the external world, it's doing the same thing with monstrosity that Ludwig Feuerbach did with gods, if sorry, I'm working on this period at the moment, so I just use that as an analogy here, then in that case, the monstrous lies within constantly all the time anyway. And Le Bon's rendition of this is that monster only emanates to become the dominant personality when we come together as the crowd. But in the Jekyll and Hyde rendition, it is simply our animalistic side, which we're, throughout all these ages until Freud comes along, we project onto the external world, seeing animals actually existing out there in monstrous forms, which are actually just the demons, as Freud will call them, and as a psychologist or psychiatrist might call them today, the demons of our mind. In that case, we're all monstrous to start with, and these are only all variations on the monster type. But a lot of human beings probably would be unhappy with that suggestion.
Thank you for the wonderful lecture. And I have a question that you have touched upon, which is connected with the ontological status and, of monstrosities and the emotive response that you mentioned, which is fear and anxiety, most of all. So my question is about the sense of wonder at the start of monstrosities and the possible as an existence of monstrosities within utopia and not dystopia.
Yeah, I think that's two questions, isn't it?
Yes, sorry.
Firstly, the sense of wonder, and secondly, the relationship to utopia. Sense of wonder obviously is there from the very beginning, particularly in the imagination of what lies beyond the known world. We're compelled to want to have to know, and the process of conquest is simultaneously the process of the conquest of the external world and the demystification of that world, and simultaneously a process of self-conquest, of wonder about ourselves, which eventually takes us back again to Freud as the final, or one of the final endpoints here. Possibility of monstrosity within utopia. Well, I mean, this takes us back, as the previous question did, to a problem of definition, doesn't it? The classical and early modern utopias, from Moore onwards, exist in a milieu, as we know from Vespucci, Columbus, and so on, engaging in the voyages, which are actually inspirations for Moore himself, in a milieu in which there are two sets of beliefs about possible utopian slash monstrous regions, which are running parallel. The one is the existence, which I showed on the one map there, of the earthly paradise lying in the earth itself. And belief in this ceases. We tend to forget today that people did believe that the Garden of Eden was somewhere in the world until about the middle of the 16th century. Then they stopped believing it. The reason they stopped believing it is because so many conquerors come back from everywhere where people said it might be and say we didn't find it. And so people stop believing, and it becomes divided into the myth of the original Garden of Eden and the myth of the world to come. But it isn't any longer a place which exists in this world. The second set, then, of parallel mythologies are all these lands equivalent to those that Mandeville describes, where you might, from a more, because we're looking at a period, you know, of about 80 years between the two, publication of Mandeville and the publication of Moore's Utopia, it is sometimes suggested that much of the reception accorded to Moore's Utopia is because, in some respects, people treat it to be a book like Mandeville's book. That is to say, it's a real voyage rather than an imaginary voyage. It discovers real things. Seen from this point of view, you might, if you were really looking for utopia, and I realize this is only one part of the question you originally asked me, you might pass through any number of the kinds of lands which Mandeville described before you got to utopia. And the question you asked me also implied, can we imagine literary utopias with the monstrous existing within those utopias? I don't know of any which do within the bounded regions of the utopia itself. Now, almost all utopias, of course, are defined by boundaries, and what occurs outside is usually antithetical or negative by comparison with the utopian qualities that define the utopia inside. Again, to use More's utopia as the generic example, slavery exists in utopia itself, but warfare, the sending out of mercenaries, conquest of foreign territories, a lot of many worse things occur only outside of the boundaries of utopia itself. My sense is that if More had wanted to spice his story up, he probably would have brought monsters in, knowing that Mandeville is exactly what everybody was thinking about, but that that's not what, of course, the text is about. Now, could you, the final part of my answer to your question is, could you hypothetically imagine a utopia in which the monstrous played a significant role? My answer to that would be to take us back to the definition and to say, aren't we almost by definition here saying that where the monstrous is prevalent, not to say predominant, but even prevalent, we're moving much more clearly to the dystopian than the utopian? Because if monsters are present there, unless we talk about a society of monsters, now Ksenia is the person to ask about this, of course, how is it that zombies get along with each other? You might well want to ask. If there is such a thing, as one might implausibly suggest, as a zombie utopia, it would of course be a place where zombies are nice to other zombies, where they treat each other with, I know, it's ridiculous, with love, respect, friendship, and so on, the crucial qualities that define the utopian trope amongst human beings. But that's going very far. So by and large, in the last part of the answer, I think not.
So we say that humans need masters as an authority. For example, in the medieval Europe, the authority was the church. They decided what were the symptoms. For example, in the witch trials, they decided who was a master and who was not. But it seems to me maybe today we can look at psychology in a bit of a similar way, because in a lot of movies and in newspapers as well, for example, the monsters back then during the witch trials, the witches, they looked like human, but they weren't exactly human. And the must, it is frequently used, especially in these days, for psychopaths, sociopaths. For example, a very violent person in the medieval Europe wouldn't be a master, he would be a very dangerous person. But today, it is very common to refer their actions as monstrous. So maybe we can, if, I don't know, what would you say, if we can consider a change, these people with antisocial personality disorder or others as masters?
Yeah, I mean, I think what this indicates in the first instance is that we've taken over the idea to describe a whole range of behavior that we regard as extremely reprehensible. This, I think, gives monsters a bad reputation. And this, I try to argue this in the book. The Nazis get called monsters all the time because that's the best we can do. Just as the description of Auschwitz as hell is the best we can do. But actually, Auschwitz, in my reading of it, is much worse than hell. And most monsters are a lot nicer most of the time than the Nazis were to their enemies. So there's a real problem with the language here. I think we need to go beyond in describing how we understand evil. It's the problem of moral vocabulary, generally. We need to go beyond this clear fixation on a dualism of the human and the animal, because it's actually the humans who are the monsters in your rendition of it. When we describe someone's behavior as monstrous, what we're saying is, this is a really evil human being. Well, why don't we say, oh, they're human? See, I imagine a world 50 years from now where robots are going to be saying that about us. They're going to be saying, how could they do that to each other? Oh, it's because they're humans. In exactly the same way as we describe the behavior of psychopaths, deviants, and so on, as monstrous. But this is a woeful misconception. What we're doing is just offloading any sense of responsibility for this behavior by saying that it is some thing or entity or being or attribute or set of behaviors that is not identifiable with the human as such, whereas a fully honest reckoning of it would be that this is one face of the human. So from that point of view, the monstrous is just a way of talking about the extremely negative, you might say pathological, aspects of evil human behavior. So it's still appropriate to use it that way, but we have to understand that what we're doing in taking up that language that was once attached to different creatures from ourselves is actually describing human behavior, not describing. We don't, well, I don't, can't say this actually, because of course the Catholic Church does still believe that it is possible to be possessed by demons. That in other words, when you have someone who exhibits extremely deviant behavior of a particular kind, it is because an external entity, you know, one of these black creatures from my illustrations flying with wings, when you sneezed or you opened your mouth to say something, flew into you and took over your personality. Well, most people don't frankly believe this anymore. We can think of someone as possessed, but we don't think of it as the literal possession by either a demon or the devil any longer. We instead use the language of psychology or psychiatry, and we say that, well, there's clearly some extraordinarily deviant aspect of this person's personality, but most people today don't believe in the devil. They don't believe in demons. Therefore, they can't believe in demonic possession of this kind. It's a metaphor. It's not a reality.
So my question kind of picks up on that same argument, this idea that monstrosity is a concept we apply to anything we identify as inhuman or that we don't want to associate with humanity. So picking up on some of the panel earlier this morning, the paintballers are called inhuman, they're defined as monstrous, even though they're human beings, you know, in the same way that the Pagoons are kind of identified as monstrous because they transgress human boundaries.
Mm-hmm.
But how does that concept of monstrosity then come into play in terms of the dystopian narrative? Do you feel that these narratives are using that concept of monstrosity, or are they actually trying to challenge it by portraying human societies in the way that human beings govern each other?
Both at the same time, without doubt. The intersection of the narrative is, in the first instance, in the creation. I mean, Atwood does have a fair amount to say about this, but at the end of the day, maybe not as much as we would like her to say. The creation of beings who are monstrous in the traditional form of use of the word, that is to say, they're an amalgam of human and animal characteristics, doesn't imply that deviant or negative or harmful or evil behavior follows from that. But if we imagine a society, which Atwood doesn't seem to do in the trilogy, as resulting, because actually this is, in many respects, as was pointed out this morning, a post-human rendition, where the humans get seen, in many respects, as the species that we ought to leave behind, because it's the more recent innovations on humanity that, in fact, are morally superior in their general behavior. So I think it's an attempt to do both at the same time. There is, without doubt, I mean, this is a tendency not just in Atwood's novels, but in a lot of recent literature, to try to pick up on the idea of a post-human and play with the ambiguity in relation to that. It's less seen in terms of traditional monstrous types, of course, now, than in terms of a machine-human spectrum, so rather than the animal-human spectrum. But of course, the moral conundrums that result at the end are exactly the same, except that you might argue you're starting out from a somewhat different set of moral assumptions. If you start out with an animal-human spectrum, where reversion to the animal is what brings out evil, or creates evil, depending on how you want to pose it, an animal-human spectrum, where machines are not programmed to do bad things, actually moves us, in some respects, in exactly the opposite direction, which is what I think a lot of the artificial intelligence debates about ethics now are pointing to. But of course, if robots are just programmable machines, then that implies they're programmable to do evil as well as good. They're not starting from a more of a neutral viewpoint.
You had one question.
class to follow up the question from here, but you sort of already answered it, because I wanted to ask about post-human monsters. So can they create this utopian society? Because when this question was asked, I thought about X-Men. So in the X-Men universe, the X-Men are viewed as monsters from the outside, but they themselves try to either distance themselves from the society or help it. And by distancing, they try to gather other so-called monsters and create their own peaceful society. So couldn't this be seen as this and similar humanization or rehabilitation of monsters which are trying to go out of the humanity way and live somewhere peacefully, but humanity goes after them and tries to hunt them down? Couldn't this be seen as this type of monstrous utopia?
You practically answered your own question. If the juxtaposition here and in any number of other scenarios is that human beings are actually the monsters and that something that they've created is morally superior to them, hence you end up with the human beings trying to hunt down and kill those whom they've created, nonetheless being the morally more culpable of the two, rather than the monsters, the human beings now revert into monsters, if you see what I mean. Then yes, the superior society, as with the issue of robots, the superior society is one which is defined by a higher ethical code than human beings have notionally practiced throughout their history. So, but that's a very neat, of course, ironic inversion of the whole monstrous trope, isn't it? If monsters are on the animal-human end of the spectrum rather than the machine-human end, if monsters are the embodiment of our sense of where evil comes from, here that's inverted completely to make the human side the evil side and the monstrous side, in fact, the superior side. So it's a great joke on the whole tradition. Whether it ends up as a utopia, of course, will depend on how you define utopia.
Sorry, Greg. I would like to ask a question and utilize my position here, because you presented a very neat and an interesting perspective from as a history of idea. Right? I wanted to ask you about a specific monster beast, the Enkidu from Gilgamesh, because we have a specific discursive curiosity. Enkidu is sent by the gods as the punishment for the wrongdoings of the king Gilgamesh. So the monster here is the punishment. And at the same time, what Gilgamesh does is befriend the monster after he proposes prostitutes to Enkidu. So my question would be, wouldn't be this first history, the first epoch in human history, already a story about breaking out of the dualism and also rethinking the relationship with the monster in a more complex way?
Mm-hmm. It's a very interesting example. I don't know if other people know of it or not. Do you know how this monster is actually graphically portrayed?
The thing is that when Enkidu invades that city that Gilgamesh is building, because Gilgamesh is building a utopian city and is trying to cover it with walls, Enkidu is sent by the gods. It is a fury beast. It has lots of fur on it. It's destroying properties. Mm-hmm. It's attacking people. And only when Gilgamesh offers prostitutes to Enkidu, he shakes the fur from having sexual intercourse with them. And that humanizes the beast, which was sent to fight with the evil king. Right? Mm-hmm. And only then Enkidu befriends with Gilgamesh.
So he doesn't kill the monster at the end of the story?
No, the monster is killed by the gods,
right?
Actually. And Gilgamesh is trying to save the monster from dying, to resurrect him. And then the snake appears, because Gilgamesh is diving in a pond, to gather a root which can cure death. And once he gets out of the pond, he loses breath, and the snake takes the root which would save Enkidu. And the whole epoch ends with Gilgamesh weeping after his lost friend. So
it certainly makes for a more sophisticated rendering of the themes, doesn't it?
Yes, yes.
Just like Beowulf. Sorry. Just like Beowulf, right? Beowulf.
But like a couple of centuries earlier.
a couple, yeah. Now, I mean, this is, of course, the source, this general period, for a great deal of the mythology that comes afterwards.
Mm-hmm. I think this
not
is just
one of the one story, but the entire culture.
This is basically the first story that we have in our culture. And it is, and it already
and
has
so many.
The snake
is right there, right?
Yes.
Through.
Yeah. I tried to ask a question, but you actually...
you sort of answered it yourself. It is a much more sophisticated rendering insofar as it doesn't give us a clear stigma attached to the monster as evil, even though at the beginning of the story he's doing all the traditional stuff that monsters do.
But at the
but
same
it's capable
time.
Of being converted through, and one would want to ask what those qualities are that enable that conversion, if there's enough in the story that can tell us how that happened.
But it also fits with what you said about the purpose of monstrosity being to, the thing to talk about human identity. Because it's also, like, puts all these points together in one narrative, I suppose.
What kind of friends are they?
Best friends, I would say. I would say, when I say best friends, I'm using a quote mark here.
They're not Facebook friends, we know that.
No, they're not.
Better than that, then.
They're on the borderline of mating friends. I would say sexual friends, couple.
Really? Because that would bring a completely different element into the story, of course.
There is definitely a moment of speaking about a friendship and even a friendship that goes into a sort of male love, I would say.
Interesting.
Love a monster, right?
Well, sexuality runs like a, solidly throughout the entire tradition, let's leave it at that.
And if I remember correctly, the monster is also afterwards loved by the people. There are two of it, Gilgamesh, they fight together, they protect the city. Mm-hmm. So when he dies, it's not just Gilgamesh, everyone gets really sad.
So are there any other questions? Would you like to add something? No. Okay, in that case...
Can we at the same time assume vampires as revolutionary and anarchist creatures? Because at that moment I want to give Bram Stoker's Dracula as an example. Mm-hmm. You know, in the story he sucks the blood of two females, Lucy and Mina, and after this event the females get out of the image of Victorian ideal women of Angela in the house, and they turn into rebellious women. And this is a result of sucking their blood. So do you think that this is an act of revolution and anarchy? So can we also think that vampires are not only evil creatures, but also revolutionary ones?
Well, that's a very interesting question. Of course, the fate of women in this situation in the Victorian context would not have been a very happy one. Mm-hmm. So if the instigation to an act of rebellion leads to social ostracism, which would have been pretty much what would have happened, and most women who fell were forced into prostitution. It was that simple. There was no other prospect of advancement in life once you lost any sense of respectability. And that's clearly what's happening here. I mean, the whole vampire trope has been interpreted, the sucking of the blood, of course, as semen and the sexual act at the same time, and that seems to come out very clearly in this particular instance of it. So is not clear today for us. It might seem like instigating a rebellion of that would be breaking free of the trammels of a kind of suffocating conformity in the society as a whole.
Because they really break the chains.
Right. But in that context, of course, you have to ask whether this is doing them a favor or not.
Mm-hmm. So maybe at that point, vampires just disrupt the order, the system. Mm-hmm. They are disturbing creatures. So in that aspect, I regard them as positive creatures rather than evil ones.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Okay.
Are there any other questions? If so, then Professor Cleet, thank you very much for a great lecture and for the great time answering questions. Please give applause.